So, this might be a series. It might not be, but sort of. Let me explain. I was sifting through my video ideas one day and saw that I had written down folk art, probably because I was watching a Mira Beiler video where she was painting what she called folk art. And, well, I really like that style, I'll say in quotations, because folk art is a pretty general descriptor. Which is why I went down a bit of a rabbit hole to see if there was a more exact name or description for the type of folk art that's popularized. Folk art doesn't have an exact definition, but there are a set of descriptors that help define the sphere, at least from what I've looked up. Internationalfolkart.org says that folk art is many things, but must be traditional, handmade, and reflect shared cultural aesthetics and values. Other than that, it can be taught formally or informally, change over time, and it is of, by, and for the people of that culture. It can serve a use or function, or it can just be pretty. There's popular stylized folk art that you might recognize from a quick Google search if you add in a specific place as well. Various kinds from China, Minge or Sumie from Japan, Minhwa from Korea, Worli paintings from India, literally everywhere, wherever you're interested in or curious about. The style that I often think about and see a lot more of is the Scandinavian style of folk art, though maybe a bit more modernized or evolved, I guess is the right term. Anyway, in doing that research, I thought maybe instead of just a one-off where I try out this specific style and technique of folk art, that I would try out different styles and techniques every, I don't know, every month? Whenever I feel bored and want to experiment, I guess. Like, next month I'll try some Sumie paintings or something. So it isn't really a series so much as it is something that I'm interested in looking into, trying for myself, and sharing with you all. Enough with the spiel then, let's jump into the Scandinavian folk art style and create something, shall we? I started with what I know best, Googling and searching on Pinterest. I looked through a bunch of pieces and tried a few out in my sketchbook first to get a feel for the style. A lot of the designs center on nature, on flowers and plants and grasses and vines, and a lot of woodland creatures, which makes sense considering the area from which the art comes from. Foxes, deer, owls, rabbits, wolves, all animals that are native to the general area. And thankfully, all animals that I've seen in real life and that I've drawn before. Just not exactly in this way. When I draw animals, I tend to draw them semi-realistically, so simplifying all of the shapes is a bit outside my comfort zone. But I know the animals well enough that it isn't too difficult, except for the rabbits at the beginning. I don't know what it is about rabbits and mice, apparently, but their shapes just don't seem to come to me naturally. Which I think is funny because I used to have a mouse and a lot of rabbits. I mean, a lot of rabbits. 75, in fact. No exaggeration. My mother used to breed and house show bunnies, if that helps explain it. Out of all of those rabbits, though, I really only owned one of them. Her name was Dora. Yes, after Dora the Explorer. I still have the blue ribbons she won at fairs, or at least I think I do. They're probably lost in storage somewhere. Point is, I am very familiar with rabbits, and it is completely unfair that I don't have the appropriate drawing skills from that experience alone. That's illegal, honestly. The interesting, and to me more fun, part of this style is the patterns inside the animals. They're pretty simple, like repetitions, but the angles and curves of them follow and complement the contours of the creature, which I think is neat. It makes them look like they're wearing their own coat designs on their fur, which I think kind of makes sense because it can get pretty cold in those areas, and the people there wore a lot of furs and coats and designs. So giving the same qualities to animals was a way of describing the nature around them. I don't know if what I said actually like made a coherent sentence, but I think you get what I mean. I hope you do. I mean, if not, I just sound a little crazy, but that's nothing new. So aside from the overall shapes of the animals, I was able to do a lot of it with my own flair from here on out. The birds were probably the easiest to make, though I do love the fox and the owl that I made. Except the owl reminds me of the Duolingo owl, and I know my phone heard me say that, so I'm low-key expecting a notification to pop up threatening me to practice German or else. Okay, I had to cut this, but my phone did buzz with a notification, and I swear to God, my heart leapt out of my chest, but it was for something else. No ominous green owls hunting me down today. Nope. Nuh-uh. Not yet, at least. Oh, I also grabbed a little Korok figurine from Breath of the Wild that my friend made me with her 3D printer, and I tried to make a folk artsy version of it. Which was pretty easy, because the Koroks have a general shape that's pretty simple as it is. It was just a matter of adding all the little patterns to it. I might have overdone it, so that's something I'll want to keep in mind for when I move on to the final piece. The designs don't have to cover the entire animal, and they don't have to be too intricate. Telling myself that now so that I don't do it later, but I mean, we'll see. With all those doodles out of the way, I made a tiny thumbnail sketch for the final piece, which is going to be an acrylic painting. I thought about doing this with markers or colored pencils or watercolors, but in the end, I figured it would look best with acrylic. You know, what with the blocks of solid color and all that. And though the thumbnail is pretty small and hard to see from this viewpoint, it got the right amount of detail across that I wanted. Just the shapes of the animals and plants, basically, because I'm going to paint the patterns on the fly when I get to that point. Also, another thing to note, a lot of these designs I've seen during my searches tend to be symmetrical, so I want to make my piece symmetrical too. Which is going to be a huge pain in the ass, I can already tell. But too late to back out at this point, since I'm recording this audio a day after painting the dang thing. And with that, there's something I want to say about this process. Now, it might just be me or how I went about it, but this painting took forever. I'm talking 5 hours. And that's just what I have recorded. The sketching I did on the canvas took longer than I thought it would too, because I was trying to make everything look symmetrical. Because I figured if I did all the legwork to make the sketch symmetrical, that painting it would just be easy, be a breeze. And maybe for other people, it would be. But I do not have the steadiest of hands, and the background itself just took forever. Oh, and the color palette I chose off of colors.com, colors.com. So maybe coolers, but I've seen everyone say colors, so I have no idea. But they have tons of palettes that you can mix and match and lock individual colors and create your own palettes, so that's what I did. Then I had to take the time to mix each of those exact colors, at least as best I could. Have you ever seen that TikToker that can color match to anything in his surroundings? Because I've seen a few of those TikToks recently, and he's just absolutely astounding. I think I'm pretty good at picking out what makes up a color, but that dude is just on a whole other level. And I don't exactly have all the paints known to man to mix. I mean, I know I really only need like 5 colors or whatever, but that requires a level of skill that I just said that I do not have. I'd like to think I'm close, but definitely need more practice, which is what this is for. So yeah, if you want to practice mixing colors, that site is a great place to go. I'll have it linked down below along with anything else that I mentioned in the video. I thought about pre-mixing all the colors before painting, but I realized the background color alone was going to take a while to paint, so I decided to mix as I needed so that I'd waste as little paint as possible. Not that any of this paint is expensive by any means, I just really don't like wasting paint. Seeing a well with a bunch of fresh leftover paint at the end of a painting is just heartbreaking. Sometimes if I have enough colors left over, I'll do a little abstract painting on a tiny canvas, but thankfully I didn't have to do that today. Of course, as I was starting to paint, I realized that this dark blue color was going to need a second coat in places, because that's just how blue paints work. If any of you have tried to paint a significant portion of canvas with blue, you'll know what I'm talking about. Blue just has a way of being transparent really easily, or at least cheap blue paints do. Though this color is predominantly phthalo blue, I also added burnt umber and a purple whose name I can't remember because it was a weird name that fit with the theme of a set of paints I bought, called Folk Art. I like their paints, they're basically another version of Apple Barrel, they're sold at Walmart, but they work and they mix well, with each other at least. Most of the paints I used for this piece was from a brand called Phoenix. I haven't heard of them before, but they're a similar, super cheap brand, though I've noticed they stain more heavily than Folk Art does. And when I mixed the two brands, I saw bubbles in the mixtures. Don't know what that's about, but they painted fine. I've already lost my train of thought, so I'm skipping on to the next thing I wanted to talk about. This board that I am painting on is a pre-gessoed aqua board by Ampersand Art. They're like a solid composite board. I don't know exactly what it's made of, but the site says it absorbs watercolor like fine paper. It's also good for gouache, apparently. I have a really old set of gouache, but they're probably no good now. I should check on those. Either way, I'm using acrylics, and I can definitely tell that the board causes the paint to dry really quickly, more so than acrylics already do, which is what I want for this kind of painting since I'm not trying to blend any of the colors together. I didn't pick it for this reason, I just sort of wanted a square canvas to help with the symmetry, and this is what I had. I bought it back in college when I visited an art shop and then was afraid to ever use them. That's the case with a lot of my supplies. I bought them up over the years and then never used them because I was scared of ruining them or running out. And I mean, I'm sort of getting over that fear, slowly. Not entirely there yet, but filming helps. And that's honestly the main reason I'm filming and uploading these art videos. It gives my art a purpose of sorts. I know art doesn't have to have a purpose, and I can create just for the sake of it, but the way my poor brain works is that I need to have a purpose, a sense of accountability, or I'm just not going to finish or accomplish anything. Chalk that up to whatever you want, but it's how I work, and I'm fine with that. I like having videos as proof that I'm doing something, you know? It doesn't have to make me money or anything, I just like sharing. Anyway, back to the painting. I realized that this dark blue color was going to give me trouble, but I'm stubborn and went ahead with using it anyway. And though these paints tend to be pretty opaque, I was worried about trying to layer the lighter colors on top of this blue, and I didn't want to cover my sketch, which alone took an hour, mind you. So I painstakingly traced around the shapes and filled in the background bit by bit. Then I would layer more paint where the blue had thinned, and throughout the painting I dipped back into this blue to clean up the edges that I missed from the other colors, but we'll get there. The next color I mixed was green, which was a combination of emerald green, a lighter blue, I don't remember the name of, some white, and a teeny tiny bit of burnt umber. Now that I'm looking at the color though, I'm almost 100% certain I have this exact color somewhere. It's like a dim sage green. But I'd already mixed the colors, so I committed to using it. And like I said, it was practice. Annoying practice, but that's sort of how I think all practice is when it's something I don't want to do. Anyway, I used a variety of flat shader brushes because I don't know, they feel best when working with acrylic to me. I know there are other types of brushes and probably better brushes for the type of lining I want to be doing, but they worked. I started trying to make the lines as correct as possible, but then I realized I'd have to fill in some white spaces with the blue anyway, so I just drew with the green paint as I pleased, knowing I would correct it later. Which probably added to the overall time spent on the piece, but it seemed like the best approach. The entire process of the leaves was actually pretty relaxing and therapeutic when I just went with it, so it works out. The next color I mixed was a warm, musty yellow. I didn't really plan which colors were going where, I just went with what felt right at the moment, and the yellow felt right. I used it for the half circle at the top to indicate that it was the sun. I started with only filling in the inner circle, but then decided that I'd fill the whole thing, and the inner circle would eventually be colored red when I got around to mixing that. I also made the bottom ferns. I don't know if they're actually ferns, but that's what I'm going to call them. I made them and the larger flower above them the same yellow to keep the visual interest fairly centered. Then I moved on to adding the red, which was a mix of vermilion and orange yellow. I used this to block out the rest of the sun, fill in the tulips, and add the berries to the ferns. Oh, and then I added the red to the korok popping out of the flower because I couldn't resist adding him in. He's just so cute. The last color, thankfully, was straight from the bottle, no mixing required. It's a color called Linen that came from the same set of paints from Folk Art. I think the set I bought was like the festival set, if anyone's curious. I used those to fill in the animals as their base color. And from here, I basically switch between each of the colors, filling in places that are shaky or messy or missing color. I use the dark blue to fix the shapes, and then I use the other colors to fix the shapes some more. And I was really taking my time with this because I was trying to be super steady. Like, I was trying so hard. I'm just not that steady, so it took a lot of correcting. But in the end, I got all of the base colors down and was pretty satisfied with it. Now, onto the patterns, which I was not looking forward to considering what I was just talking about, you know, with steadiness and stability and all that. I hoped at first that I could use my paint markers to make my life easier, but unfortunately, a lot of them were dried out. And the ones that weren't dried out didn't fit the color scheme at all. So that's something I'll have to put on a future shopping list. In the meantime, though, I came to face the fact that I would have to do all of the patterns with the tiny spotter brush and hope for the best. Which is what I did. I started off easy with the little red dots to fill the spaces between and on top of the leaves, built up my confidence, and then started with the bunnies and lost all the confidence that I had gained. I used the same red to line their back legs and went back and forth with whichever color I felt like using, adding details to the curves and feet and neck. I did the same thing to the bird, adding details as I saw fit, and that's kind of how it went. So I'll just let some music play while I finish up the piece, and I'll see you in a bit. And with the signature finished, I think that completes it. It took a long, long time. But I really enjoyed the time painting it, and the result is something I'm proud of. I'm sure I could get used to this style and do more of these in the future, maybe mini ones? Who knows? This was a fun style to explore, and I'm excited to try others. But for now, thank you all for watching if you made it this far. If you enjoyed it, leave a like or maybe a comment down below what you thought. Have you tried this style before? What do you think? I upload every Tuesday and Friday, so be sure to subscribe if you haven't already to see more of my content when it comes out. I hope you have a great day, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye-bye!